Series is really good because, hey, think of how it's grown this year. We've got another special cars out there. Good night, how many? And I foresee more. Before I get started with Gene, there's one fella here, some of you guys from Georgia may not know him. Steve Cooper is here. I want him to stand up. He's got a 68 Dodge Dart straight from the factory. Got all the documentation on it. When he was 18 years old, he bought that car. He still has it. But it's covered up in the back of a shop.
But we're going to uncover it.
And it is a lightweight.
We're going to go over and uncover it.
Lightweight, one of 50 that Chrysler made. So we're going to. And we'll interview him next year. That way we'll be sure to get him here.
He might leave.
Because he's got some good stories to tell you about it, I'm sure, at 18 years old. All of us have, and there's one more fellow I want. We've got people that are famous all the way to California here. We have J. Ed Horton with us from Belton.
He's in the back over there.
Where's J. Ed at? Some of these Georgia boys may not even know you.
Get him up here. And,
to get him back, we'll interview him back next year. But J. Ed, probably most every one of you been in anything about racing have heard his name. Built dragsters. A fellow went to school with him. In school, all he cared about was welding and stuff like that, and his family wanted him to go on and do other things, and he wanted to work on cars. Little did they know that he'd work on cars from here to California. So interesting stories there, but we'll get to that later. We can't unload everything in the truck today. We've got Wade Bryant here. Now, he's from Georgia. He's another legend. They said we're legends in the paper. I don't know what a legend is. I think a legend means that you're old, first of all. And as long as you're a walking legend, you're in pretty good shape. All right, let's flash back to 65. Flashback to 1965, A-Gas was like pro mods to some of you younger guys. They were being built here and there. Gene Cromer had started building a Willis A-Gasser. Hallman Moody, he kind of had the info in the back door to Hallman and Moody. 427 high rise, everybody's excited about building. I'm building an English Ford, the second one in South Carolina. First one in South Carolina was the guys from Greer, Christian Roper, sometimes I can't remember that. A group of guys, I think three guys had it, wasn't it, Gene? I don't know of any Willises in this side of, in the area. Gene's was probably the first Willis in the area, I'm pretty sure, if I'm correct. So I had barely finished my car up. They had a race at Donelson Air Force Base. How many remember Donelson Air Force Base? They had a race at Donelson Air Force Base, the one and only they had.
It's supposed to have been a big event.
And it was the, what'd they call it, championship or whatever, for media, nationals, that's what they call it. And so finishing up cars, Gene had never, he finished his car up there. The car had never been down a track. Had you done a burnout in your driveway? I don't think he even got to do the, he's done a plenty of burnouts in his driveway after that, but that car was actually finished there. This is a fairy tale story almost to believe that you could go. I do not remember how many A-gassers were there. I would say close to 30 maybe, Gene, somewhere in there. But I'm going to kind of let Gene carry on this story some, but I will fill you in on this. Snapshot, you know, you look back, you got snapshots in your brain. I have the snapshot of him running the finals. He ran against, I think it was a red English Ford in one lane. Gene's in the next lane. Everybody from around there's pulling for Gene, and he's in the finals. And they had lights there. And he took off, and the wind light came on in his lane, starting a series, and I'm going to ask him, and he'll tell you about that in a minute, I think, of 28 wins out of the first 30 races. Phenomenal for a gasser in that time. But Gene, tell us a little bit about the Willys. Some of these guys have never heard you tell some of the things.
Well, I started building in 65. And actually, that was the first race. I just got it ready for that race. Ran it over there. In the meantime, I was at 13 Forks before I finished it. And Arnie Bissig was over there. They had Arnie over there running. Well, he's run old hydro, old cast iron hydro. And I bought a spare hydro, and that's what I put in the Willys to start with. Well, I didn't like it. It wouldn't come off the line. It was so slow off the line. And I ran it two or three times, and I couldn't stand it. So I got it out and put four speed in it. And that's when it come alive. And I ran it, three or four years, I guess, with a four speed. And I went to C6, and then I went to C6 with a clutch in it, and then back to just a regular C6. And I ran it up to about 73, off and on. In the meantime, I built a Mustang funny car, and I built a Maverick Pro Stocker and ran that for a while. Didn't like the Pro Stocker. It was out of my league, out of my money. And so I went back to the Willys and ran it. And then in 73, I guess that's when I quit running. I had two girls in school, and I had to make a living and get them through school.
Wait a minute, don't forget about that 55 Chevy with a Ford engine in it.
55 Chevy with a Ford engine.
Well, when I was building the Willys, I got so tired of working on the Willys, I pushed it outside for a year, I guess. And I built a 55 Chevrolet, and I took the engine out and put in the Willys and put it in the Chevrolet and run it. It was 427. Ran it, and I sold it, and went back to work on the Willys and put it together. And ran it, and it did real good. And ran a lot of places and had a lot of good times, a lot of good memories, a lot of good people.
Tell us about now one end of the A-Gas record you had.
Yeah, I think, Mr. Butch, I can't remember all that stuff. Everybody else tell me, I don't know.
Do you remember some of the numbers on the car? You know, the half quick or mile power ETs?
Well, the best it ever ran was about a 983 or something like that, 145.
Says Gene Cromer right there. Look at that number. Read that number right there.
Put your glasses on.
Tell you while he's reading that, tell you another snapshot in my mind. I'm standing at Ware Shows. I'm on the concession side. Gene's in the right lane. He lets go of that Willys, and it had the automatic then. He stood it up on the back bumper, and it left, and he went in second gear while it was still up, went down and ran the first 9-second run at Ware Shoals in a gasser, 9.99. Don't remember the mile per hour, but that one is a snapshot. While Gene's reading that, I want to say this. I talked about him behind his back, talked about McDowell to his face. But Gene Cromer is one of the finest guys that you'll ever meet. Amen. Most of y'all know that already, but some of you may not. I cannot remember hearing anybody say anything bad about him. And he was always a genuine competitor that would help you if you needed something. Same way with David. So just wanted to insert that in while he's looking at that.
Here's ET Hill, 979.
979.
Yeah.
And Gene came to 13 Forks was my track. I want enough to buy a 62 Buick Invicta. Had to paint it. But I forgot it might have been $400. I want enough and saved enough to buy my first big large screen. It was large then. It's probably about like that. And I had my corner to make my money. And then every once in a while, here he'd have to come. Or here he comes. And it wasn't fair.
They told you would win $42 a week. That's where they showed up.
Oh, man. Now, second fairy tale story, unbelievable, too. Can it happen two times in a row? Gene built the Mustang, what do you call it?
Roadster.
Roadster. Had no top on it. Gene builds the Roadster. He hasn't finished it yet. Finished my story.
Well, I finished about 6 o'clock in the afternoon. We had to be at Peeling, South Carolina at 9. I got there at 9 o'clock.
Never had been down a track.
Never been in it. And I pulled up, they was waiting for me. I told them I was going to come. And I pulled up my line, and when I did, it fouled a spark plug. Well, I went ahead and ran it through, and I come back, and I had low ET of 7 cylinders. So, put spark plugs in it, and didn't know which way it was going to go. Every time I'd burn out, it'd go to the right. Well, I'd back up, and it'd go straight. But every time I ran, I'd let them get a head start on me. And I caught them. I won the race first time out.
First time out, first time. I've never been down a track till it finished it out in Dragstrip.
Yeah.
That is phenomenal there when you think about it.
How crazy.
We were young and dumb. Bulletproof, 10 foot tall.
Yeah.
If you visited 13 Forks track today, you'll know what I'm talking about, because it wasn't much wider than this room here.
It wasn't that wide.
While I'm thinking about adding anything there, and Gene and David can help me on famous cars that came to 13 Forks. Y'all think about 13 Forks as a little old bitty track out in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah.
But there were some cars there. He mentioned Arnie Bezzin a while ago. There were some factory Hemis that came by. Who named one a while ago told me was here. One of the Hemi cars that was raced by name team. Somebody told me a name.
Ford factory cars. Ford sent Hubert Platt and Bob Coble, the two factory Mustangs.
Yep, that's right.
The 13 Ford to be the kid in the Hemi cars.
And who was that? Yours truly.
And I won the race, and Monday morning, Ed Skelton called me to come over and asked me how I would like to run Ford. Said he could get Ford furnished to me.
Factory back.
Yeah.
Cool.
Sat in into the story. I got that letter of greetings.
Oh, off you went to protect our country.
Yeah.
Any others that you add? I was there, and as usual, I was waiting for the final run of Top Eliminator to get my money. They weren't there. And I'm thinking, this is pretty good until they towed in a... Who remembers that day? They come towing in and unloaded a jet dragster.
Yeah, I
can still hear the magneto popping while they were trying to crank it, worrying he's going to burn my fiberglass off. And you could hear whatever they were turning and all, you could hear the magneto popping the current across the gap, whatever gap they got or whatever. And they tried and tried and never got it to crank, but I think they got their appearance money. And it kind of registered after a while. They didn't want to run as bad as I didn't want to run.
Well, there was a lot of people thought that after he got in that thing and he got to look in that house, they think he backed out.
Not a bad idea, was it? Any other famous calls?
Yeah, sure did.
Any other factory backs or some of the cars there that you can think of? I remember Ed brought of course, we got pictures of Ed Skelton with the Falcon. And then Ed also, I remember him running another snapshot, 66 Fairlane with the tunnel port. Now, the tunnel port Ford, if you don't know about them, the reason they call the intake ports about like that, and they tunnel through it and encapsulated the push rod in a tube. And it had so much flow in the head that it killed the bottom end of it. And he would get that thing going, and I was looking through the back window of it. He would get it going as the light started coming down, and then right before they got to the bottom, he would bury the pedal and sidestep the clutch, which Jimmy was driving. And the tires would go smack to ground. It looked like it was going to collapse them.
I think there's a picture of it right there on that table, Butch.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
Old Ben Jones used to run over here in that
place. Ben Jones.
Hey, Butch, I remember running.
Yeah.
A match race at 13 Fork with a Henry, West Virginia Henry. I had a match race with him. He's from some part of West Virginia.
Now, where was it here?
At 13 Fork, yeah.
Yeah. So, our little track's had some names on it, too. McDowell, David, has also had one end of the A-gas record.
You don't look too excited about it now, though, does he?
I had both ends on 8th of a mile.
Both ends on the 8th of a mile. He's trying to remember. I told somebody, they told me back again about something this year, and I had forgotten it. No, I know. It was David's Camaro you seen there. It was sold later and called Rockin' Robin at Greer.
Yes,
some of you may not know
Jimmy
that.
Hall. I didn't know
Jimmy
that.
Hall bought
Jimmy Hall
that
bought car. Rockin' Robin.
I didn't know that. I know everything, but I didn't know
and
that.
And I forgot about it. They told me this year. Somebody told me again this year, and I'm just as happy to know that as I did last year. That's good thing about getting older.
Well, I went to Jiggy's side last year. And the guy showed up from North Carolina with a Henry J. And I can't remember who told me, but I'm standing there with four or five guys, you know, we're watching the race. And one of them said, "You see that Henry J right there? Yeah, that used to be the Little Lemon." Oh. I said, "Ain't no way. That used to be the car that somebody told me at Ware Shows. That was the car." So what you think I done? I tore off over there. Here I go. And I asked the guy, and he said, I don't know. I can't tell you. I bought it from an old man in Charlotte, North Carolina. But it don't have a straight axle. It don't even look nothing like the Little Lemon did, you know. But I'm just curious, where did that car go, David? I mean, who got that car? Could that be that car?
I do not know. I sold it to a boy in Anderson. And he moved to Charlotte. And he had the car together, and he run it a time or two. But, I mean, I never did. I don't know what ever happened to him.
Well, he said he bought it out of Charlotte. That's what he told me.
But he did move to Charlotte. But, I don't know. But I mean, I haven't had no track of that since then. But my Camaro did Jimmy Hall. I sold it to him when I built that A-gas Vega. And he run it like it was for a long time, except it painted red.
Yeah,
and called it rock
and roll.
Then he finally took the straight axle out on it and put some kind of other one in there. Yeah. That was a good car. That Camaro was. It had a long enough wheelbase, you didn't have to worry about it.
Anybody got any questions you want to ask Gene or if they can't answer it, I might remember it because I'm no, I'm not younger than him.
Not those either.
Y'all, by the way, Gene, this Willis has been resurrected, and Gene drove it last Saturday. It was Saturday night, wasn't it?
I said.
He's still driving.
He still raises the front tires off the ground.
Exactly. Exactly.
Y'all never did talk about his roadster. The Mustang roadster.
Yeah. Yeah, that was the one we talked about. That was the one that he finished at the drag strip the second time he finished the car at the drag strip and won the race. That was the roadster.
Yeah.
I almost call it the top. It didn't have a top on it. And that's, yeah, roadster is what that. Correct.
Put,
yeah.
I did have to put a top on it one time.
Yeah.
I run the top a couple times with it.
I used to see him run at Jeffco and
Jordan. Yeah.
Gene, tell how your car got its name.
Moonlighter?
Yes, sir.
My wife. She
That's a hard look at it.
I was all out, always outside doing something in the moonlight. Had to work on it at night.
But I don't know if all of you know exactly how this thing happened on the Willis and how it got back to where it is today. For years, the car was in pieces behind Gene's garage. He parked it as a complete vehicle, and there were some things that transpired, some promises that were made, and they didn't kind of get answered and around and all, and the next thing you know, he's got a pile of parts in the back of his shop and a bare frame out there that used to be the Moonlighter. That transpired on until he retired, and then some things happened there. Gene had some health difficulties and such. And for about probably 100,000 times, people would say, when you gonna get the Willis back together? He probably got so tired of hearing that. And so finally, amazingly enough, different people involved in this thing, honestly, I call it the retribution. I honestly believe that God looked down on a man that had kind of been wronged in some promises and some things, and he put it in the heart of some guys that didn't even know that it was happening. And he put it in their heart that they wanted to help get that car back. And one of them was Greg Porter, another one was Chris Dunn, and then several, then it just snowballed. And the next thing you know, it began, and then of course the Pro Mod driver, Quayne Stott, he actually started the talk, and the enthusiasm was all there, and then he started putting hands on. And it's a beautiful story of retribution, of guys that didn't even know about that, never understood what was going on, but they just wanted to see it run again, and it happened.
Yeah, I got a call one day from Quayne Stott. I didn't know him. He told me he had a DVD when I ran at Shuffletown in Charlotte. He wanted to run down and show me. I said, okay. The next day he was down there. He's from Columbus, North Carolina. The next day he was down there, and we talked. And he said he used to watch me race when he was 9 years old. And so he wanted to build a gasser like mine, so he bought him a fiberglass body over here in Georgia. And I went with him to get it. And he built that thing in about 3 months. He built it in record time. And then when he got it built, he said, I want to put yours back together. So he carried my chassis and everything up at North Carolina. He did a lot of work on it. He did the new roll cage, just redid the whole chassis and all. Then brought it back home. And all these guys from around here started coming over, started helping. And I don't know how many, 25 or 30, I guess, and all. And they put a time limit on it. This was in about January. They was gonna have it ready in May the 25th to run it, to show it at Greer. So went to work on it. I mean, everybody. And I built the engine. I just had parts left over from the 60s, and I just put what I had in, built the engine. They did all the body work and everything, and the guy that painted the car, he's here now, Chris Harper. He done a great job.
Let me interrupt you right here. Where's Chris?
He's out there in my truck asleep.
In the truck asleep.
I'm telling
Let's
you.
Let's go out there and talk to him, Butch.
You look at the paint job on that vehicle. There's not many body and paint guys that would take the time to do the proper work and proper the blocking and all the hard work.
He did a lot of work
for nothing that a guy could. That I'm telling you, he did a great job.
The whole article.
3 weeks. Yeah.
3 weeks.
3 weeks.
Wow.
The whole article is on the internet. If you can just search Gene Cromer, and you go down. It has Moonlighter the Resurrection. You click on it, it tells the whole story of everything. It's good. And also Writer's Journal, I don't know if anybody's ever heard of that or not. There's an article in Writer's Journal of the whole car and all.
And you can see it, some of you may not know, you can kind of see it in progress. Is it still on there?
On that ham side, if you, that's what I said.
Yeah, on that ham.
If you go to, or if you just go to ham site and Gene Cromer or whatever. It's easier for me. I go to Gene Cromer and click on the Moonlighter Resurrection.
I seen a little clip of where they first started up first time. I didn't see it all. That was interesting. Yeah.
Well, any more questions? We don't want to hold you guys up too long. If me and McDowell get wound up, we'll keep you the rest of the afternoon.
Well, I ain't got a question, but I want to say something. Wade had talked to Gene, and he was hunting some Henry J. Spindles.
Uh-huh. There you go.
And Gene called me up and it's like, Lynn? I said, yeah, this is Gene Cromer. Gene Cromer? I ain't talked to you in 40 years. Yeah, Gene, how you doing? He said, I'm talking to Wade Bryant the other day. He told me you may have some Henry J. parts. I said, oh God, he's got Alzheimer's. He don't know what kind of car he's fixing. He's got a Willis. He is so confused. Yeah, Mr. Gene, I got Henry J. Spindles and stuff, and if you'll come get them, I'll give them to you. I'd just be happy to help you. And I'm thinking the whole time, God, he thinks it's a Henry J.
I was wanting the front brakes.
Oh, by the way, that Hemi out there, guys, we need to thank the owner of that for bringing that thing out. Listen, that is great. Have all of you looked at the speedometer on it? You know how many miles it's got on it? 272. Amazing.
That's a low mileage used car right there. Matter of fact, we might auction off here in a little bit.
Quarter mile at the time. Somebody had their hand up.
I bet you bought new one.
I bet it
was.
For
all the young shavers who run around back then, y'all explain why the drags closed down and what happened when they closed down.
You folks around here, if you've got a copy of that newspaper, have I got my copy in here?
It's over on that table.
Okay, I don't want to forget it. I want to get me a copy.
Yeah.
But the article in there is about this gathering today, and it tells about some history of 13 Forts and Neil and all of the. And is Roger here?
No, Roger's got the stones by us. I was going to tell you all ago.
Yeah.
I called him. He said, hello. I said, Roger, are you not coming today? I got that stones by us. I said, please don't come. Stay at home.
Yeah, Roger was the flagman. Yeah. But anyway, what happened there is explained in this article here at the what's the name of that track?
Yellow River.
I was going to say Yellowstone. Yellow River, which some of us just call Covington. Yeah. That drag strip there, was it Hubert? Or not?
Houston.
It was Houston, yeah, his brother. Yeah. Houston was running, and we have a picture of the car here today. He was running, and a spectator, and he had a parachute funny car. A spectator leaned over somehow, and when it ballooned out the parachute, it caught the spectator in the parachute. Instantly killed him, and his weight over on that one side jerked the body off the car. The body goes into the stands and kills 24.
No. 11.
11 or 12. Sometimes you'll hear 11, sometimes 12. And 46 people, I think, were injured. The court systems and the regulations and the rules all got together and said that a drag strip had to have $1 million insurance every week. Every time they opened up, they had to have that insurance. It ran many, many small tracks out of business.
It closed them up.
And Jeffco, how did Jeffco remain? Because I raced at Jeffco a couple of years after.
Well, they had a purple track too. That may have helped them because it may have been like a
song. How many raced at Jeffco?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Tell
them
about that.
Yeah.
I was in 13 Forks, the son of Houston, wrecked. Like I said, I was a teenager.
Yeah.
It almost ended my racing career because it came over the news that a drag car had gone out of control and people killed. You know, my mom knew that I was in Georgia racing.
Oh.
I got back home and didn't have a cell phone.
Yeah.
She was so scared. She said, "You'll never leave here with that race car again," and put me through that. Well, I just thought about that when you was talking about that race. Mm-hmm. Coming down with Houston.
Exactly. And by the way, let me mention this one. We got to shut her down here pretty quick. If you look around here in that degas class, there was a young whippersnapper that gets paid off about every week here. And I did not know him at that time. Later on, you know, came to know Gary Burel. But I didn't know he snuck over here in Georgia and got that Georgia money. Our historian. Little did I know. There he is over there. And one day he'll be the historian of Elberton 13 Forks.
He got $7 one time, $9, and then $10.15. And then, you know, that was big money. Gas was 29 cents. You know, really. $10 was big money. But I seen where you won $50.
That's why I came.
You were buying gas, he was buying a Buick. Yeah. I'm gonna say one thing, now Gene, I got a problem with putting a Ford motor in a 55. I mean, that's like messing with mom's apple pie. We could have put it in anything inside a 55.
I had a lot of fans.
So we know where the cotton picker car went to.
It went Jerry Johnson.
Jerry Johnson bought it.
He bought it from me. Jerry sold it to a guy that worked at one of the dealerships.
He did, and I think the car today is somewhere in Greenwood, South Carolina.
We traced it. It moved from there. Unless you find that to be true, let me know, because I know maybe the Lord will put it on some of your hearts to resurrect.
Just a hint. I'm going to tell this story on Gene. Gene never did get out running much. But he put that 55 Chevrolet in, he put that 427 in there. And I had a big gas Henry J. I believe I had a Henry J then.
I don't remember.
Benny, I outrun that fifth, that Chevrolet with him, that 427 man. Boy, he had a hard time about that. You remember that, Dean?
No, I don't remember.
I did, but you did have a...
I just remember the good times.
I'm just saying, that's the only time I ever... Gene had a hard time living that day with everybody going over the shop and telling him about that Chevrolet outrun. I guess that's because he put that Ford motor there.
One of my favorite times was, it was on a 4th of July run at Ware Shoals. And again, I had to run Gene there. And we were running, I think, with the AFX and A-Gas running together. The funny cars and A-Gassers. So I had 55% in a stock motor.
Nitro.
Nitro methane. And I don't know how it lived through it. That was the time I told you about is picking the wheels in fourth gear. Well, anyway, I get up there with Gene, and Gene, something happens that old Detroit locker, and it kind of went over, and he had to let up and get it back in it, and I outran it. But I tell you, the crowds, the A-gassers came back up the track, and there were people just multitudes on July the 4th on that side of the track and on that side of the track. Don't tell how many people were there on those big 4th of July runs. And when Gene came back up track pulling his, I mean, they were hollering, screaming for him. When I came back, they were hollering, screaming for me. It was just, it's that good.
One of my moments. They talk about 13-4 has been a bad track. Well, it wasn't wide, it wasn't the best. I got that. Started out running some of these other places. I found that out of a Cadillac over there. If you go to North Whittlesburg, Summerduck, bad racetrack. Summerduck probably the worst track I ever run on. When you went through the darn starting line, and about it was 8 miles Dragstrip, man. I mean, I'm talking about some $5 cars running up there. I mean, I had a match race with Roy.
We run a quarter mile on. Yeah. That should my eight.
But it, no, they was running the 8th though, back, but they, oh, yeah. Run, they had a, let's say, Roy Rick Hill and Ronald Lyles and Lee Edwards and myself, Wade Hager, somebody else was running up there. And when you went off the end of the track, about 100, 120 feet from the end of the track, you run off in loose gravel. Well, when I hit that gravel, I'd have been around and around about 5 times. But that was a bad place to run.
All right, any more questions before we cut to commercial?
If you can tell about Melvin driving them wheels.
Who is Melvin? Who's that sign?
He knew this story was coming, so he left.
You might want to get him where he can take care
of himself. Well, they had a run what you brung race, and I carried the Willis and the Mustang. Well, it came down, I had to run myself in first place. And it made both cars run. So I let him, I said, Mel, you're going to drive the Willis, and I'm going to drive the Mustang. But now you're going to win the race, and I'm going to come back and win second place. So we did. Got up there, and Mel and I never had driven a Willis. I said, first thing, do not red light. I'm going to win second place. So he didn't red light, but he never get a 40 mile an hour. I passed by and let up. I thought maybe he'd come on. Passed by and let up. He won the race, and I won second place. Well, I got lynched.
I've been
mentioned his name. In fact, he's on one of these, the Mustang running there, Charles Head. Charles Head passed away a couple of years ago. And a guy comes up to me with a magazine last year, year before last, at that car show. Where's Ray? At that car show we were at. Anyway, his car was featured in there. We ran into Charles 20 years later when my son started racing. We go to wear shows. Here's this guy with a hat just like Lynn's. And he looks just like Charles Hedden, but just 20 years older. He'd been there the whole time. And there he was. But he had a 63 and a half face back, 427 forward. Had 17,000 miles, was it, Ray? But it was featured in a magazine. Some guy had bought it. And they had a whole full article in there.
Well, did his neck come out and then go back and had a Google spot?
That's Charles Head. That's Charles Head.
And yeah, no, I said, that's
that. Well, in Tennessee, bro.
You could tell when he throwed that dog.
Well, in Tennessee, he had it in the back.
It's like a buzzer.
That's why they called him Buzzer.
Fell in Tennessee, bought the car.
Fell in Tennessee, yes.
Yeah.
Was it? 3 years ago. Oh. See, we got on
the
Charles.
I saw it coming in. I said, that shot of me on Toro, and he didn't know what it was. And the fellow asked me, he said, where's 13 Forks Dragstrip? I said, I couldn't, there's no way I could tell you I'd get 13 Forks Dragstrip. Said some paperwork was in the car when he got it.
Oh. He let that thing sit outside for years, didn't have any place to put it. But another good driver.
Was Charles racing then?
The second time, yeah, his son was, and he was still running too.
Yeah, he was a foul keeper. Yeah.
Blue and silver, ain't that right? Yeah, they bought it from Charles, and they're from Tennessee. Well, that's enough to tell you. Do what? All right, that's enough tales for this time. We've got to leave something for next year. Lynn?
Well, it's my turn.
It's your turn.
What can I tell? I don't know anything. I'm merely the messenger.
Hey, the connection. Lynn kept telling me about, I sold his daddy this Buick motor and this Studebaker, and finally I saw a picture of it and the light bulb came back. I remember it. Some things are a little fuzzy, you know, when you picked this up years ago.
Well, I threw the gauntlet down last year. I'm going to throw it again. I got a Henry J. sitting up in the shop. You a big block motor man. If you build a motor and get us a transmission, we're going to have a little lemon too.
Oh, yeah.
And I think we ought to be working on another cotton picker. But I know a guy's got an angle sitting right here at this table. And I know a guy's got a Buick motor that I think would work out pretty good.
Hey, Lord willing, next year we're going to drive our tow truck over that pulls the cotton picker.
Yeah, that'd be cool too.
59 Ford. Daddy bought it brand new, 59 Ford F-150, and I drove it for 100,000 miles and then put three different Buick motors in. It's going to have about a 600 horse Buick motor in it now. That my son may have went a little bit overboard on it, but anyway, we get it finished up, it'll be here.
See, but Lynn, that means you got to have one next year.
Butch has got some nice Buick now.
Well, I just think it would be so good to have them cars back again. We got that Moonlighter. Then we had that cotton picker and that little lemon. And maybe the Kublai Khan and two or three more of them cars. I think he backed up in age about 15 years when that car
I think
it.
He did.
What about Ruth?
Is that right, Gene?
Both of them have.
I can tell my body that.
Somebody missed it, but there's one over there called One Arm Bandit.
That's him right there.
No, that's another one he's talking about. Tell us about it, Gary. You know more about it. I remember the car, but I didn't know the guy.
Well, I didn't know him either. I've seen several One Arm Bandit cars down through the years. And
55 Chevrolet. One on Bandit. That's what I had on the side of it. Yep, that was it.
Yeah, maybe it.
Yep.
But that's been so long.
One arm batted. At least five.
I'm going to say something about this Gary Burel here.
Here we go. Here we go.
I mean, it's nothing bad here. me and him been friends a long time. I've worked for him. He's done this, and I've built motors. I've done everything. But there ain't not anybody that I've ever seen step to drag racing like Gary has. He's been racing from today and still racing today. And I mean, and he works on, he always got that mind of going somewhere or another. If he got something running good this week, he's going to change 14 things. But now, Gary, ain't nobody as devoted to drag racing as Gary Burel. Stand up, Gary.
He's done more with one arm than most people done with two.
That's right.
He wasn't happy that $7. He kept on racing.
Yeah.
He's one of my heroes.
$7 was pretty good back then.
That's right. It ain't all the money he gave her, Dale. Gary is a heck of a good fellow and a good man. I've known him.
It's all about Will.
Long as we won't even talk about it.
If any of y'all got any ideas, that man's going to write a book. Me and him have discussed this. He's gonna write a book. I got the first copy. It is mine. It's How to Race, Cheat, and Win.
Here we go.
No, but I raced Gene in 1968 at Ware Shows. Now Gene don't remember, but now here's the thing, he'd raced a lot of folks and I run a lot of folks that he don't remember. But you know me, I remember it, you know. And that's one of my good memories. And I was talking about this fella in 13th Forks. He couldn't get his jet dragster crank. I don't know where that day. It was hot. That poor fella, he was pouring sweat. Had jumper cables running every which way. And you know, and it was a pretty junky looking old. It had to look like made a bed rail to me. I kind of like that other fella. I don't think he wanted to get it cranked.
It wouldn't ever stop over there.
Well, it was kerosene running down the hill, you know, trying to fire
you
it up.
Smell it. I remember smelling it. I was just a youngin'. I can remember the smell.
Yeah, I went over and looked at that thing. I thought to myself, I can remember this. That man's going to get killed if he tries to go.
I might have not been sitting here.
Didn't it rain before the day was over that day?
Sir?
Seemed like to me it rained and they got it cranked after the rain or something like that.
Maybe after the race,
yeah,
later.
Real late in the evening before they got started.
Yeah,
Neil think... says we all left, but we got it started. He made his run, you know, make sure we all knew he actually run down the track.
Yeah,
he didn't say how fast he went down the track.
40 miles. If Melvin drove it, it might have been 40.
I tell you what, I tell you something else about Gary. He always got some stuff patented, and he'd be a millionaire today, right? And he's come up with a lot of good ideas. And stuff that ain't nobody ever thought about.
Look, David,
he got me, I'll tell you what, he got me in, I don't know what year it was, 74, 73 or something. Talking about wanting to build this delay bomb, where you could punch in 3 seconds, 5 seconds, 10, 5 minutes, no matter what. I was an electrician, I on the job. Anyway, I rammed up a bunch of stuff. I built him a box. And he go up there and peek at this other car, he's spotting in 1.5 seconds. He could dial 1.5 seconds in that box, and that's when his car leaked. Well, finally, 7, 8 years later, MSD come out with that same thing. But Gary had it 5 or 6 years before MSD ever thought about it. Ain't that right?
So tell it that, Gary, you tell the rest of that story about how you like to close the drag strip down, because nobody could beat you. People just quit coming over there.
They got so mad. I, you know, I had to skip around. I didn't come back to the same racetrack. I had 4 racetracks. I had at that time, Ware Show, Greer, Shuffletown, Atlanta, and Shadyside. And every week I'd go to a different racetrack. They'd give them a week or 2 to cool off. They'd figure out.
he done it on his own too, and he experimented. And Wade Bright tell you that if he's got a car running good this week, he's still going to change three things for next week. Ain't that right, Gary?
Never satisfied. Always looking for a better mousetrap.
I'm not going to bother him no more, but he is a good friend of mine. He's a heck of a good fellow.
Well, Dougal, he done my engine for a number of years and had fast motors. And what he was really great at was taking what you had and making it work. You know, it didn't matter what you brought up there. You know, you didn't have to, I mean, if it wasn't a great motor, but he could take that motor and jiggle it around and do this and that and get a feller to deck it just right and pay him extra money to make sure he did it right. And he would make you a good engine that would live. And I've got three of them today, two 427s and a 496, and one of them have been fired up. They part of the family. I guess I'll hang on to them. I don't need them. I don't have anything to put them in. But,
Gary Lynn's going on a trip tomorrow night. If you want to call him while he's gone, y'all talk the whole time he's riding.
I'm going to log chain them things, right?
Well, now he said he's going to get rid of them. He told me the other week if I wanted to build one of these new tractors, he let me have.
Yeah,
I thought he wasn't getting rid of it, but he said I could run with
it. I'm doing all I can do to get these guys back in the program. Yeah. And I told him I'd furnish the motor if he'd furnish the race car, you know. And then I'd even let him drive it. You know, four-speed car kind of rough for me right now.
I'll furnish a Henry J if he'll furnish the motor. Well, if somebody would give us a good Jericho four-speed, we'll be racing next year.
I got a soft spot for a 55 Chevy. I can't have it. I know I'm not the only guy.
I have too. That was the first car I ever had.
All right, well, I'll be in on it too. Let's go. I'll help y'all, whatever you need to do.
And I think today I jumped, I think, 955 Chevrolet making degassers and race cars.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And I put one with a straight axle under. That's back when running degassers. Well, Butch was running a Studebaker, or Buick. What, he was running a Studebaker, start with.
Started off with a 51 Mercury. It was too heavy.
But I mean, I'd buy that and then I'd sell, somebody wanted, I sold one of them to Ronnie Edmonds. And we ended up with it, didn't you?
Yeah, that was the old Gold Rush car. I don't, y'all probably know it. It was a really good race car. And I had a good 55, the gas hopper, that picture that's over there. And I got drafted in 69 and had to sell it. And when I come back out of service, I bought a 55 Chevrolet, the old Gold Rush car. And it turns out it used to belong to Dougal, I do believe, but it was a really good car. And it's in Saluda, South Carolina, but the people won't talk to you about getting rid of it.
But you imagine how much all in 55 be worth today.
Is that a feller? In the Saluda, was it a gas?
It was
a white 55?
No, it was blue when I had it.
What's the guy's name?
Rowe is his last.
Yeah, Frank Marvin Rowe. ML Rowe.
What'd you ever do with a blue 55? What'd you ever do with a 55?
He still got that car. He still got that car. That's where I live.
Oh, you just salute him?
Yes.
With the guy, last name is Rowe.
Frank. Yeah. ML Rowe.
Sold him.
Frank Rowe.
You seen him lately?
They brothers. They about five, six of them.
But do you know anything about that?
Yeah. Yes, sir. It's sitting in the garage down there. It's got the 427. It's recessed. The wall set. I mean, the motor's recessed back in the firewall. 55 to a hardtop.
And what color is it?
It's white now.
Well, he was in it for hot and heavy for a while, but he didn't give it up. But they ain't coming to stay in the area, they might give it up. Last story about McDowell. He was so poor when I first met him, and he was hot rod, and he was in what grade with that 55 Chevrolet? He couldn't afford a floor sheet. He just cut a hole in the floorboard and put two levers up. He hanged his thumb on the reverse, this three-speed reverse low back here. He hang low with his thumb, bring it up to the gate, let go of it, and shove back. That is true. I don't know where I had to get. I had a Ford. The Roger King. I don't know where you know him. I talked to him today, but anyhow, he was come today, but he can't. He loves them game cars. There wasn't no way gonna do that. Well, I got a lot of him. I was talking to him. Me and him, he said. I seen him the other day, and he said, Gene talked about the Ford. He said, well, see, me and Dougal, they call me Dougal, that's my nickname, too. He used to be married, just like man and wife. And you know how Roger talked about it. Yeah, he said, what do you mean? I said, he said, well, he said, we kind of got a divorce when he bought that 55 Chevrolet. So Ford was screwed with the diehard car, Ford man. So we were good friends.
but I mean, neither we got a divorce. And I had never thought about it like that, but that was
good. Yeah, I thought that, man.
But Roger, he got messed up.
Yeah.
All right, so I tried to get him to come, but we've enjoyed it. I really have. And, I ain't going to tell no more tales.
Well, that saves some. Thank y'all.
Let me say this, Butch. I don't know. A lot of people probably know, a lot of people don't. Phil Bonner died Monday. Diddy Warbucks. And I think he probably come to 13 Forks several times. But he passed away Monday and buried him yesterday.
I heard of him before. I can't face his face up there.
He's got a Thunderbolt Fairlane in the museum.
Okay.
And Lynn.
And one more thing.
Just said one more thing, y'all.
Bobby's got the camera on here. Everybody that raced at 13 Forks, walk up and look at that camera and tell us who you are. We make it.
Just stand up where you're at and go around the room and introduce yourself if you raced at 13 Forks.
We just want to kind of keep up with who's here. Who's
I know Barksdale did.
Don't want to talk about anybody that's here and can hear.
Y'all don't win, you still got a wrong for your prize.
Howard, I guess you don't want.
Catch him going out the door, Jerry.
You gotta have a door prize, don't you, man?
How you doing? I'm Lynn Lee. I never raced out there at 13 Forks.
Probably a good thing.
And I hung on that fence, and boy, I ruled these guys on this. Dave McDowell over in there, little Lynn, that guy over there, and copy. Hey, got right in the moonlight.
All right, y'all hang tight just a minute. Everybody sit down. Just sit down. We got a few door prizes to give away.
Hey, Lord. It's sliding off, huh?
Y'all know over here. I need to get right here. Okay. The first thing we're going to give away, and I know some of y'all are not from Elkton, but A1 Tire on the Bowman Highway above Elkton has given a free oil change. And I don't know where my glasses are, so I can't see. Frankie Johnson. You know where A1 Tire is? On Bowman Highway. This one is it's to Anderson Auto Parts, Napa Anderson Auto Parts. It's a $50 gift certificate. Tony Holman.
Yes, ma'am. What did I win?
A $50 gift certificate to Anderson Auto Parts. We have three caps, all that were donated by Napa.
Larry O'Quinn.
Oh, yeah.
Got his name. That's a Rojo 55 Chevrolet.
Juanita Johnson. Which one you want?
Look into.
Got two more. I'm just going to draw two at one time. Jamie Dixon, but they gone, the church. Okay. And Fred Tibbet. All right. Wait a minute, I got one more.
Look here, don't y'all start telling stories if I done quit now.
All right, y'all, this is a female gift, so if a male wins it, this is your wife's Christmas present. Maybe. Gary Burel.
Help save us, man.
That's
what you
said. Okay. I'm not sure where Lynn went. All right, we still got t-shirts for sale. Now, with that being said, Mr. Gene's got t-shirts for sale, too. Where are yours? In Miss Ruth and Jean see them. We still got a few more 13 forks over here. And still got barbecue and stew for sale if anybody wants any. Okay? And I don't know where Liam went.
Throw
one out
and re-gift this.
What?
I'm happy
just
to be here.
You sure? I'm going to re-gift
my
gift. You sure? All right, we're doing a re-gift, Gary, Tony's gift. Howard Barksdale.
Howard.
Howard's birthday. Happy birthday, Howard. You got a $50 gift. Okay. All right, hang on. We're going to re-gift one more. I like this. This is the oil change to A1. Wayne Whitfield.
Got you a hat. Didn't even have to be here.
I
got a nappy hat. We done got you. Nah, you did good.
That's a good birthday present, man.
See
you. But you were there.
Huh?
You were there.
Oh, yeah.
All right. What about you, Wade? All right, Butch.
All right, this is Butch.
Sign it out.
All right, man. Ah, a lot of... No, man. I know who that cat is right there. That's Mr. Cromer. Mr. Cromer. So I wonder how he got the name Moonlighter. Man, the... All right, that's Mr. Burel. I got him.
1967, 18 years old. Had a great time.
All right.
Are they going to have a group picture out there?
I don't know. They didn't this time. Lynn dropped the ball again, didn't he? And
y'all kind of come in together now.
Better put a tall one in the back and a short one in the front.
Howard.
Howard gone, I think.
Is Howard gone?
Yeah, I'll back up right here.
Come on, get in the
room. Howard's up there.
Where?
Right there.
I'm finna say, Lunsford, you need to get in there. Y'all, hey, y'all better bunch up.
He's gonna change into Superman.
Where's Melvin? Melvin!
What?
Oh, get in the picture.
Lynn, stand up.
Let's give Howard time to come back out.
Yeah, well, they put him in the back and hide down.
I told him, I said, man, I said, I got to wear my clips and stuff. I said, y'all going to Georgia country. That's a new bag.
I got my Gamecock underwear on.
They beat Georgia.
Oh, you're in the dark. You have to.
Vic, I can't see you. You gotta step up some.
This way, Vic.
Okay.
There you go.
Vic says, I'm trying to hide. Y'all leave me alone.
All right. That felt good. I'm gonna get to the side.
I would never get you.
He's hiding. This week time to use the brake.
Oh, yeah.
That wasn't wrong with it. It had been sitting too long.
Yeah. That'll just land it at the shop.
That's right. That's what it did. Look, them old shoes and stuff like that stick. If he mashes them too many times, he won't get it on the trailer. Hold him out.
This ain't as maverick.
Yeah, I like it. I like that too.
That's the first time I've seen this one.
Lynn told me he was going to bring out. There you go. Knock a shine off that thing for me. Heavy for me. I don't think he meant to do that. I don't think he meant to do that. Turn it loose. Road, Gene. Show us something, boy.
Nice paint job on that thing.
Yeah, it is. They done some waxing on it. I can tell you that. It looks good.
It's sharp.
Go right ahead.